All right, hey, I'm back. And I gotta tell you, it's more than a couple days after the concrete pour. But I wanted to wrap this episode and show you the results. It was a chore, I'll tell you that. I didn't even have the hard part, but I was doing some vibrating of the concrete and doing a little bit of floating. And then the hard part for me was really operating the power trowel. And it really took a lot out of me, not the least of which is I'm terribly out of shape. But anyway, a few days have passed and it's good news, it went well. Good morning, welcome back. This is Mike Torino, and this is episode 27. Today is March 25. Today is the day that we pour the flooring in the garage. And I'm here, 06. Wanted to get here early, make sure everything's prepared. Our electrician has done a lot of work. We've got lights and fans working. And you can see, we've got our compacted gravel like we shown in the last episode. And then we have 12 millimeter rebar, 12 inches on center across the entire floor. And our electrician has conduits run for all the electrical outlets. This is the sump pit. And we've got electric coming in here that's going to power the 1 horsepower electric pump down here in the pit. And we've marked off our line for our concrete. And the guys have snapped a chalk line all the way around the perimeter of the wall where the concrete will go, the height of the concrete. And it's kind of funny because they used their method where they use a rubber tube, transparent rubber tube with water in it to find level. And then they snapped their chalk line around it. And then I went and checked it with my rotating laser level, and it was right on, perfect. Here we have the newest member of the gang. Hello, this is Valentina. Say hello, Valentina. We are ready for our pour today. We got a power trowel here waiting for us. We've got about 120 bags of cement. And I've got one of my additives that I'm going to use for this, made by Owens Corning. It's a polypropylene fiber we're going to add to each batch. I think the way that I figured out, I'm going to use 1 teaspoon per batch. And when I say batch, I mean 1 drum of our concrete mixer. Right now, I just want to show you the floor and how it turned out. Again, this was 4 inches of gravel and 6 inches of concrete. I'll just kind of walk around and pan around a little bit. Like I said, we've already started bringing some of our household goods up in here. And we started the pour from this end and came this way. And by the time we were halfway through, my shoulders and arms were roasted.
I can't imagine how the crew felt, because we did this from a one bagger mixing machine and had to bring it in here by buckets. And the crew always got disconcerted when I used the vibrator, because they would pour it about 6 inches high, then I'd hit it with the vibrator and it'd fall down to about 3, which is good, but in their eyes, you know, it's just more work for them. But once we got down to this end, it was about 5 o'clock. And I had the power trowel and float in sections, you know, about 8-foot sections, which was hard because the whole thing was curing at different rates. So by the time this area started curing, they were over here, you know, pouring wet concrete. So it was hard for me to get in there with the magnesium float, because I didn't really have anywhere to stand. So I tried doing it from the doorway, tried it from the garage door, and I was able to get this area pretty good, pretty flat. And after I floated it, I put the pan on this power trowel, because I read different things about using the pan versus the blades versus both. So I did both. I put the pan on here first and I panned it, and it seemed to work really well. I did get this area that you're looking at here a lot flatter than the rest of the garage, I think because I had more time. And after I panned it, I removed the pan and power troweled it, and it really put a nice finish on it. It's got a lot of dust on it right now, so you can't see it. But if you've ever done it before, when you use a power trowel, you'll see that the concrete gets real smooth and it almost turns a kind of blue. And that's what it looked like. And then, you know, after the midpoint, it was just catch as catch can. We had different pours going on, and it was no longer a linear pour. It was like there was some that way, some over there, and they backed out on this section. So it was very difficult using the power trowel. And what ended up happening was I got a few high and low spots in this area, but it's not tragic. I mean, I'm still pretty happy with how this turned out. It is smooth. It's going to work out real nice once I clean it up, get this dust off it. We created these lids for the septic tank. These two, of course, lift off here to give access to the inspection ports. I don't remember if I showed you the steel door installation or not, but it's obviously finished. These doors are in, and they're roll-up doors. They also turned out really nice. What I plan on doing with these is I'm gonna buy some brush blades. I think they call them brush blades or blade brushes that you can attach here. And they've got like horsehair ends to help seal the sides of the door as well as along the top. And then when we poured the floor, we left this little lip here, about a 2-inch lip at the bottom. Things are starting to heat up. Let's see what we got going on. We're staging our gravel, staging our cement. We've got our mixer, and we have our water shield and rail mix. And inside of the water shield, we added our 1 tablespoon of fiber. This is what the fiber looks like.
We've got a couple of barrels of water standing by as well to keep going through the cycle. Got my power trowel standing by, as well as my battery powered vibrator tool and my bull float. So I think we're gonna start pouring on one side of the garage while a crew put some forms up over the septic tank to configure the lids for the septic tank inspection ports. Here's one of our carpenters forming up the inspection ports for the septic tank.
So we have a problem with our cement mixer. It stopped on us and we had to unload it. Luckily we didn't have water in the drum yet. But since it's unloaded and it's dry, I'm curious if I could see the fibers, and I can. They're getting well dispersed in here. So that's working. Now we got to get our machine started again. So this was a hard episode to film, mainly because it took so long. And after we finished, I was too tired to finish it up. So I know it's a little disjointed, but I hope you enjoyed watching it. See how we do concrete here without a truck and without a concrete pump. So that's it for now. I'll see you next time. Thank you.